Hey, Sheretta, thank you for breaking down Black girls in STEM with me, which is a very hot topic. We previously did a segment on gender differences in STEM or gender disparities in STEM. Yeah. So there are gender disparities, there are racial ethnic disparities, but you focus specifically on Black girls and Black women in STEM. And you developed an intervention to address that issue. Tell me more about this intervention you have.
Yeah, so thank you for having me. I'm really excited to talk about this. And so the intervention that I have is titled Girls Count 2, the number 2, a culturally responsive curriculum. And so this curriculum is designed for middle and high school Black girls, and it has two major tenets. The first tenet is to get them to understand the importance of a healthy racial identity, racial pride, gender pride as well, self-esteem and self-efficacy, so they can bring that and be confident learners to the classroom. And the second tenet of that is to expose them to information about the history of Black women in mathematics that were invisible. Katherine Johnson, Mary Haynes, Anna Easley, other Black women who made significant contributions to STEM. And then we also want to make sure that they're aware of that history, because a part of it is you can't be who you don't see. So we make sure that the curriculum is centered around that, and we start in early middle school for that as well.
Now, I wanted to ask you about that, because you said you referenced middle school and high school, but you also have argued that we should start even earlier. Like, how earlier do you think we should start getting Black girls interested in STEM, involved in STEM, and more importantly, teaching them about these figures like Katherine Johnson?
Absolutely. And so I think it needs to start in elementary school, because when we look at things such as the achievement gap, that begins in third grade. And so we start seeing the widening of the gap. And for some reason, Black girls are always compared to either Black boys or either white girls. And so their voices tend to be drowned out in this conversation. And so I believe we need to start as early as elementary school with things such as informal learning opportunities. Get our girls signed up for robotics. Get our girls signed up for science fair competitions, because a lot of that has to deal with confidence and the perceived lack of skill on their end. And I do think that schools have to be more representative also of Black girls in these sorts of science and STEM competitions, but also just be aware of Black girls' needs in this space, because they're often overlooked. So I think if we start early, get our girls informed in extracurricular activities, offer more informal learning opportunities, I think we can begin to really address the gap much earlier than starting at a middle school.
And so it sounds like maybe as soon as they start school, like maybe kindergarten, like talking.
Kindergarten. Oh, absolutely. Kindergarten. Yeah, absolutely. Kindergarten. If I could even go to preschool, just playing with the blocks, having conversations about that, numbers. And one thing I want to say is another part of our curriculum is that we introduce them to Egyptian mathematics, how those mathematics started, the history of that. And so we have a mathematician come in to let them know our presence, the African presence that has always been in mathematics from the very onset.
Now, can you just say more about Egyptian mathematics? Is it just the fact that the Egyptians mastered math, or is it more than that?
So it's the fact that Egyptians master mathematics, but it's the introduction of hieroglyphics and what that actually meant, the calculation of the pyramids and sort of what went into that, the role of women, but also men in collaborating with that. And so it's the early science skills and the math skills that was sort of implemented from day one to sort of assist with this as well. And so we let them know the history of it, because a lot of our girls come and believe that other racial ethnic groups made a significant contribution because they don't see themselves and they don't learn about this in traditional math curriculum.
Right. So you're centering math in the context of an African country and Africans going back to antiquity.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Wonderful. That's right. Okay.
That's mind blowing to our students, because they've never heard that before. You know, they're in, you know, middle and high school before they've heard this conversation, and even about the contribution of Black women in math. The first Black woman to receive her PhD in math. And so they're shocked by that. And then we also have them do book reports and poster sessions where we invite the university to come in and to ask them questions about their hero of choice and to talk about their contributions to math.
That's awesome. Now, we're both at universities. So what can universities do to foster more Black girls going into STEM? What's the role that you think universities play in this issue? Obviously, we don't want to wait until they enroll in college, if they enroll in college, because the majority of the adult population doesn't pursue a post-secondary education. So what can universities do about this issue?
There's two things that universities can do. The first is that identify faculty and staff on your campus who is doing this work, who are engaged in creating bridge programs, who are engaged with after-school programming, where they are contributing or trying to increase the representation of kids of color in STEM. That's the first thing, because we have faculty and staff who are doing this important work. The second part is that if universities are trying to identify and understand the STEM gap and trying to understand where do they start at, collaborate with your youth serving organizations. Collaborate with your STEM schools that are in your community so that you can identify talent, so that you can partner adolescents with a professor, so they can have opportunities to work in a lab, because a lot of this is about access. And I think that when universities make an effort to become more community engaged, to be more effortful in terms of making sure that we're reaching out to youth serving organizations and schools to identify talent that has been historically underrepresented and excluded, I think that we can also make a path that way as well too. So the resources are there, but a lot with our population is the access to it.
So access and probably exposure. Young girls
exposure,
need
absolutely.
People who look like themselves in these fields so that they can be inspired.
Absolutely. And one of the things, Eleanor, I wanted to add is that even myself, I promote and provide opportunities for high school students to come in and to do research with me. And we make a partnership with their principal, with their counselor, and they're there learning about social science as well. But I also make the effort as a professor to go out to high schools and say, hey, this is an opportunity that I'm having.
Right.
This is a summer research opportunity. And I would love if some of your students who are interested
right.
to participate as well.
Right. Yeah, I do the same. So it's good to know that we're both, you know, engaging in that. So thank you, Sheretta. This has been very enlightening. Thank you for breaking down Black girls in STEM and what we can do right now. Thanks so much.
Thanks for having me.